This is Dave from Unplugged Woodworking, and today I'm going to be building one of these benches. This actual bench is going to be getting built today. Anybody that's interested, there is actually a guide that we can release with this video to build this bench. This is an old bench, it's also got a shear force attachment, and this is a medium bench here, which I call the poor man's bench. So there'll be plans and a guide for the three of them. If you want to have a look at those, there'll be a link in the description. So I'm using reclaimed wood. This is all I've got. I'm not going out to buy new wood. This is really good wood. This is Sapel. I've used this on about three or four builds now. It holds up quite well to the, you know, to the boost that you will give a Roman workbench. If you're building one of these, I will suggest that you use a hardwood and not a softwood, for obvious reasons. As you can see, we've got holes in here where there was actually iron coming in at an angle, and this was used to fix these to a wall. These were actually taken from Newcastle College when I was working on site, and we're actually skipping these, if you can believe that. You know, you are a bit beat up, these ones. I think they were just like kind of left to one side, and you know, they got ran over and everything by the tractors and whatever else, forklift trucks. So basically, what I'm going to do with these, I'm going to join these two edges. I'm going to get these glued together, possibly get them trimmed up to a rough size, and then we're going to be ready to add the holes for the pegs and for the legs. So for this build, I'm going to be using maybe two benches to try and simulate some sawhorses or even two chairs. I may even use one of the benches and a chair, just to kind of show you how I do things, and to show obviously it is very possible. Okay, so as I said, I've got to join these two boards together. You might not be doing this, you might have a slab and you might be ready just to flatten the slab. Obviously I haven't got a slab, so I'm having to join this. So to try and imitate using sawhorses or two chairs, I am actually using one chair in one Roman workbench. Is what I've done, I've actually clamped the section of wood just with some clamps, and then I've clamped a clamp to the workpiece, or in your case it might be a sawhorse or a chair. So you might need someone to actually, you know, to study this. So, you know, grab a friend, grab your partner, grab the kids, whatever, you know, just to study it out where you do this. Now that I'm set up, I'm basically just going to joint this edge, joint the other edge, and get it sewn and ready for glue up. I'm not going to go into too much detail. I've already done videos on this, and there's a lot of other people that have done videos, so, you know, go and check them out if you need a little bit of help with something like this. So I've just jointed the two inside joints. I'm going to glue this together. If you are gluing up like this, I would urge you to fight as much as you can and get one of the sides, preferably the top side, what you're going to use as a top side if you have a preference, to try and get your two boards to meet, or your two sections of wood to meet, without any steps. Obviously, the more you fight and the more you get it aligned now, the less you've got to do later. I'm not too concerned about the underside, it's more the top side. So if you've got a preference to what's going to be the top, try and make sure that the top's, you know, as best as you can get it, basically. So the glue's dried overnight, I've took the clamps off, and basically now is what I'm going to do. I'm going to dress the top it's actually not too bad. You know, I'm pretty lucky. This was pre-dressed. This was, you know, obviously this was reclaimed timber, so this was pre-dressed. I took my time clamping it up, which I talked about earlier, and you know, it just really needs a light cleaning up. So obviously if you're using like a slab, you're gonna have to, well, you're gonna have more work basically. I'm not really gonna go into that. There's plenty of videos out there, so you know, go and check them out. As I was saying, on the underside, there's a bit of a step. So as I was saying earlier, I made sure that there was one side that was going to be good, which is obviously the side I've just shown. So I don't know if you can see this on the camera, but there's actually quite a big lip there. Obviously there was a discrepancy in the two thicknesses of this material. Also there's actually quite a big chunk taken out, so obviously this determined that it was going to be the underside. So you might have this problem if you're using you know, like a slab. This might be like technically the way in the edge section, so if it's on the underside, it's not going to affect you, so don't worry too much about it. So this isn't actually quite as good as I thought it was. I am actually having to take off a lot more than I expected. So I have actually transitioned to my number 4, which is working a lot better than the number 5. There's a bit of a belly in the middle, so I am actually having to go across the grain and obviously diagonally, and then that'll be followed up by straight passes. So I'm getting pretty close now. I've had a lot of problem with the grain, so in between the cabinet scraper and this card scraper, it's helped us out quite a lot. So there is like a few little things I'm going to attend to. Cleaned the top of the what's going to be the bench top up basically. This edge going all the way along, I'm going to clean that up, and this is going to be my reference edge, if you like. So from this edge, everything's going to get taken. So what I mean by that is, I'm going to use this edge to square down, to draw me square for this edge to be cut. It's the same, going to be the same on the other side. But I'm also going to use this edge to reference for all my dog holes and such. So this edge, I'm going to take a little bit extra time and make sure it's nice and square. Obviously square going this way and square going along the whole length of it. I'm ready to cut this to length, so I'm just going to square a line across and I'm going to cut it. I'm going to be using a Japanese saw, but you know, anything you've got's going to do the job, so don't feel you need to have one of these. So when we're marking out, don't forget we're going to reference from our reference edge, which we took the time to make nice and square. Something to note here, I only used a pencil line here. That's because I'm using this saw. This saw is very, very fine. If I was using a coarser saw, it would have split out a lot of the fibers, which you don't really want. So if you are using a coarser saw, I would advise you to create a knife wall all the way around. That's going to stop your fibers from splitting. I'm ready to start cutting the legs. So as what I've done, I've actually clamped the section of timber that I'm cutting for the legs to the bench top. Obviously you've got the weight of the bench top. I've got the bench top clamped to what you would be using, possibly sawhorses or chairs. So the extra weight's going to help you a lot. What I will say, when you are selecting the material for your legs, make sure the materials, the grain in the material is as straight as you can possibly get. this is just going to make the leg strong. If you've got grain that's running out the side of the timber, it's going to make for a weak leg, and you really don't want that because there's going to be a lot of stress that's getting put on these legs. So as I said, try and select the straightest grain possible. So I've ripped all the legs now, and I've actually cut them to rough length. So is what I've done, I've actually drilled a hole in the bench, and this is going to be one of the dog hole placements. And is what I'm going to do, I'm going to use a wooden dog. If you want to build one of these, there'll be a link somewhere up here. Really simple, really quick to build, really effective. So is what I'm going to do, I'm going to pop this in and I'm going to use it as a planing stock, what it's intended for. I'm also going to use some of this non-slip mat, rubber mat and stuff. I use this all the time, it's really good. So basically I'm just going to quickly clean the legs up. These don't have to be, you know, perfect, but you know, just make them reasonable. Don't forget to take the sharp edges off, because when you are using a bench, you're probably going to rub your legs against them, and if you wear shorts like I do, it can actually cut your skin. So, you know, take your time and take the arses off them, etc. So I've cleaned the legs up and I'm now ready to mark out for the leg holes. I'm going to drill through from the top. Typically with things like this, it tends to be drilled from the underneath, for the likes of Welsh stick chairs and Windsor chairs, any type of stake furniture. But I'm going to come through from the top, and I think this is going to be better for a lot of people. Basically, if you come through from the top, you're not going to be able to blast out. If it was reverse, if you were reverse and you blasted out, you know, if you had an accident, particularly if you're a beginner or if you're not used to doing things like this, if you blast out the bottom, it's not a big deal type of thing. So that's kind of what I'm doing it for. Plus, it's going to be easier down the chat, my personal opinion. So I'm going to mark out from the top where I want it. And then what I'm going to do, I'm going to square a line all the way across the bench. So don't forget, when we're doing this, we're actually going to be using the side. Remember, we actually marked it with a face mark, and this is going to be the reference side, which is this side. So everything wants to be taken from this side, because we know this to be true and square. So once I've done that, I'm then going to mark out for the leg positions. So the sight lines for me, I'm going to do these at 38 degrees. And how I would do that is basically I'm going to use a regular speed square, and I'm going to find 38 degrees. I'm going to mark 38 degrees. And then I'm going to use a sliding bevel, or a T-square, I believe you Americans call it. I'm going to set it to the line I've just drawn, fix it, check it. Then is what I'm going to do, I'm going to reference me bevel off the side. I'm going to use a ruler and I'm just going to get it into position. So I'm happy with where that is. I don't know if you can actually see this yet, but here is where I'm going to drill. I'm going to drill here, and my sight lines are going here. So when I'm drilling, this is going to be what I'm going to be gauging for me left to right, on my 90 degrees. Now I'm ready to drill for the holes. So I'm going to get the bracing bit ready. I'm going to get it in a little bit, Now, once the screw portion's got a little bit of a bite, you can actually, you know, gauge what you're kind of doing. So the sight line, what I was talking about before, the sight line's pointing this way, and this is basically my sight, you know, that's where I'm looking. So if the sight line was here, my body would be positioned this way, and that would be my sight line. But as it is, sight line's this way. So when you're following this line, you want to be 90 degrees, and because we're drilling at a 15 degree angle, you also want to be checking this way. And while you're not all the way in, you can actually move it around a little bit, get it to where you want it. So again, when you get yourself in a little bit, you want to stop and check and see where you are. And obviously it's going to be the same for your bevel. At this point I would normally ream the holes, and I would use something like this. This is just a piece of oak. It's got a conical tenon on it. I use this solely for a jig, because I do a lot of things like this with furniture, and obviously I've built a lot of these benches now. So for anyone that hasn't got one of these, and most of you probably haven't, I would recommend making at least one of the legs. You probably should do all four while you're at it, but at least one of them, and make sure one of them is really square, you know, for straight. So what I've actually done here, I don't know if you can see this, but I've made a cross, and then I've drew a circle with a compass in the middle. That's 5/8, and then I've just measured down 6 inches, which is roughly twice the size of the Veritas tenon cutter that I'm using. And this is just, this line here is just a rough guide for when I start shaping for the conical tenons. It's not really important, as I said, it's just a rough guide. But when I make conical tenons, I would normally just use my shave horse. Obviously, I know everybody hasn't got a shave horse. If you have got a shave horse, use it, it's going to be easier. I am going to use my shave horse, but I'm going to show you how to do one as such. So I've basically got the bench top that's clamped down to my bench, which would be acting, which you would be using maybe a sawhorse or a couple of chairs. You'd probably be better off getting somebody to sit on the bench for a little bit of extra weight. So with this, I'm going to use my draw knife, spoke shave. If you haven't got a draw knife, you could possibly use a chisel just to rough it out, and then finish up with your spoke shaving, and obviously a tenon cutter. If you haven't got a tenon cutter, it is just going to take you a little bit longer to do. You will need a reamer, obviously, to ream the holes. You could do just round tenons. I have actually done benches with just round tenons. You know, it is possible. If you get the ebook that I was talking about at the start of this video, it does actually take you through how to do the round tenons. There's nothing hard about it, so you could do that if you don't have a tenon cutter or a reamer. So if you have got a draw knife, I'd really recommend you using it. So I'm just going to start on the corners. So if you haven't got a draw knife, you could use a chisel. And that's going to hog off quite a lot of material, but I have got a draw knife, so I'm going to use it. Ha ha. and then we just turn the piece around. So if you notice, I'm using a rubber mat, and I'm also using a clamp. You know, the clamp's a pretty decent clamp, and obviously the rubber mat helps to keep this in place, so there's very little movement in this section. So I'd highly recommend you get one of these. I think these are like, they cost like a pound. I think in America, like, you may be able to get something like this from the dollar store or something. So it's going to be the same process again. Just take the corners, and then the middle. Pretty close, so I'm going to use the tenon cutter now. If you haven't got a tenon cutter, get yourself a piece of thick wood, drill a hole into it, the 5/8, and then use a reamer and obviously ream the hole out, and that's going to help you get the fit. Obviously this is a lot easier. I'm just going to marry this in with a card scraper just to neaten it up a little bit. And there we have it, one conical tenon. Yeah, so I'm ready to ream the holes now. If you can remember what I was talking about before, I'm not interested in the condition of the underside, as long as it's reasonable. Obviously, you know, if it's got big bows in it, big cutting in it and stuff, it's going to be an issue. But this is pretty straight. The only problem with this is that it has got a bit of a step here, which I'm not concerned about. So obviously we're all going to have to redraw with sight lines, which isn't a problem. So again, I've got the bevel that's set at 38 degrees. I'm going to get it in the center of the hole. I'm just going to put a ruler on there, and I'm just going to redraw the line. That's just a guide for me, just to sight down, that's all it's for. And I'm going to do the same the other side. I'm going to get the reamer in, get it lined up, and I'm just going to start reaming. I'm going to check with my template. You can see obviously when I'm lining it up here, there's obviously an equal gap, or near enough an equal gap that's going down. One thing to take into consideration, if you do have a step, which I do have, you might have to pack one of the sides up. So when I'm doing this, what you probably won't be able to tell is that I'm putting the pressure on the back. If I didn't, it would rock. So you don't really want anything like that. You know, you might have to put a board all the way across, you might have to shim it up. You know, if it's really, really bad, you know, depending on how you want the legs to look, you know, it might be beneficial for you to straighten it out a little bit, but I personally don't think it's necessary. So that doesn't look too bad, and I'm just going to try and make my way all the way through until the top of the tenon comes through the top of the bench. But you can actually see now that at the very top it's pretty narrow, and then when you come more down towards the bottom here, it's actually a bit of a gap. So this tells us that I've got to angle my brace more towards myself when I'm reaming, just ever so slightly. Yeah, a thing to note as well when you're doing this, you also want to use your square and check your square going left to right of yourself, and that's pretty bang on. So don't forget to use the square as well. Yeah, it's not too bad there. So I've got one done, obviously going to do the other three. I've finished reaming all the holes. I'm happy with all the fits. It's time to glue them. You could actually leave these loose if you've got a nice tight fit. If you've used a tenon cutter, you're probably going to be able to, if you want to, leave them loose. You know, a few swift taps with a mallet and they ain't going to go anywhere. I've obviously used this technique. I've actually got a bench where the legs are removable. Obviously on this one I'm going to be gluing these up just for everybody at home so they know what they're doing. When you're putting these together, what you might find, you might have an inconsistency in your legs. So I'm basically going to exaggerate a lot what you might be seeing. So you might actually see something like this. Obviously this is a great exaggeration, but it basically means when you've reamed it or you've drilled the holes, something's went wrong basically. What you want to do, you want to spend a little bit more time reaming, and also what you can do is you can actually just twist the leg, and what you'll often find is when you're twisting it, it'll actually line itself up. So when you're doing this, you obviously want to check in this plane for your legs to get the best, you know, the best damn line up you can. You also want to be looking down the two sets of legs to get the best line up possible. Yeah, if it's, you know, if it's not great, don't worry about it, because these benches are actually like really forgiving. So you know, if it's out ever so much, you know, don't fret about it. The bench is still going to work really well. It's just maybe not going to look too great, but as long as it's going to get your woodwork, and that's the aim of the bench, you know. With this bench, I'm actually going to put a rail across the two legs. So this is going to be for me to like experiment with, and you don't have to do this, but if you actually put a rail across it, you are actually able to hang your tools off it, you know, the likes of a number 4 plane, a number 5 plane. But when you do this, put a rail on it, you're actually able to span a board going from one leg set to the other leg set, and that's going to act as an underneath shelf where you can actually put tools out of the way momentarily. If you're using them and you don't want to put them on the ground, you know, the ground might be wet or there might be concrete, so you don't really want to be putting sharp tools on the concrete. It's going to dullen the tool. This will also strengthen the legs up a little bit as well. As I said, this isn't necessary, this is just something I'm going to do. So if you are going to do this, is what you want to do is you want to get a flat piece of wood and you want to get it lined up with the piece you're putting in. So it's just a flat edge. So you may be able to see what I'm talking about a little bit better here. Obviously I've got a gap here, so I don't want this gap. I want the rail to be sitting flush like so, and you want to have that on the two legs, or the four legs rather. So when you've got them lined up like so, just give the legs a little tap. And for my reference, is what I'm going to do, I'm going to draw a little alignment line on both legs, and I'm just going to mark them one, two, and two. And this is just a guide for me, so when I come to glue these up, everything's lined up, I know where everything's going, and there's going to be no mishaps. I'm happy with the alignment now, so there can be no mishaps, as I've just said. I'm gonna put the legs in, so I'm just gonna line these up with the lines that I drew before, and obviously the matching numbers, the corresponding numbers, so 2 and 2, and I'm gonna have 1 and 1. These tenons are protruding a little bit too much, so as what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna wipe the excess glue off them and I'm gonna trim them down a little bit. So now that we've done that, that's going to allow it to split the tenon just to make a split, really, just so we can get our wedges in. I've quickly made some wedges off camera. If you are interested, these are really easy to make. If you're interested, I've done like a 60-second video to show you how to make them. They'll be like a cord somewhere around here. They're really easy to make. When we're wedging these up, we want to make the wedges wedge apart this way, or wedge the tenon apart this way. We don't want the tenon to be pushed apart this way. Obviously the grain of the wood's running this way. If we start putting wedges in, it's just going to push the grain apart. So when we're doing it, we want the tenon to push apart against end grain to end grain, and it's just not going to split that way. It would take a lot of force for you to actually to break the timber going grain, end grain, end grain. It's just not going to happen. So as I said, you want to be holding your chisel this way, get it in the center, and we want to be getting a couple of taps on it. I'm just going to apply a little bit of glue, only to one side. You don't need to do the two sides, just one. Get that centralized. When that's done, you should really let this dry. I've got things to do, so I'm going to cut them now, but you should really let the joints dry before you put any more stress on them. Ready to level the feet now. So as what I've done, I've brought this onto my decking, which is kind of reasonable. I've put some MDF down on both sides of the legs. I don't know if you can see this at the back here, but I have actually just used my ruler to lift it up slightly. I've been very lucky here, as it happens. This was near enough level. Sometimes is what you'll find, you'll have to actually put packing into maybe one to two legs, you know, three legs. It really depends. So basically I know this to be level, and then from that I've leveled the top of the bench, packed it up. So what I would recommend when you're actually measuring out the legs, you want to measure out a measurement. If you take a measurement from the ground to the back of your knee, slightly above the back of your knee crease, and I would call that your measurement. So when you've got that measurement, you want to add about 6 inches to that measurement, you know, and that's going to give you like a lot to play with. So obviously these legs are longer than I need them to be, so I know my measurement is 48. So is what I would do, which I've already done. I've measured down 48, I've marked it, and my mark is here. That's my mark there. So I've just used this, and this is actually a wedge. I've had to put a little bit of packing on it, and I've just taped a pencil onto it, and this is just going to allow me to go all the way around the leg and basically get me level line. So that's all we do, we just kind of draw a line and we just make our way all the way around the sides, and we do that on all four legs. All those legs are marked. I'm just going to cut them now. So as what I've done, I've actually just put a little piece of timber underneath the leg to support it, and also to lift it off the ground. I'm just going to use my Japanese saw. For anyone that hasn't done this, this might seem a little bit awkward because it's a compound cut, but kind of just stick with it, take your time, you know, don't stress about it too much. sides are flush now, and as what I'm going to do, I'm actually going to put a little chamfer on all the edges of the legs, and this is just basically going to stop the bottom of the legs from splitting. So I'm just using my little 101. This comes in really handy for things like this. I'm ready to start drilling the dog holes now. So I've basically marked them all out where I want them for myself. If you're unsure what you're doing with the dog holes, I'll put a card up here somewhere. There's basically a video when I went over explaining where you should put them, where I put them, why I put them, where I put them. Alternatively, if you're going out to purchase the ebook or the e-guide, that's got plans, and that's obviously it's got 3 or 4 plans in it. You'll be able to get the dog placements off that, but I still urge you to make your own dog holes and add them as you need them. That's going to be the best way. If we get the screw portion lined up, we're going to get the screw portion in a little bit. We're going to start getting the drill piece in a little, and then is what we're going to do. Right, I'm going to check it for square, so we're good that way. We are not good that way, so I'm drilling it too close to myself, so I need to go away from myself a little. Yeah, that's a lot better. Yeah, we're good. So as you're drilling, you want to stop several times and just make sure you're still square. And we are. Yes. Well, I've got the camera set up in this position, I may as well show you what I mean by chamfering. So this is just a big countersink. If you're interested, there will be a link in the description. And basically, and that gives her a nice chamfer. And this just basically lets the pegs enter a bit easier. Obviously, and there's no sharp edges for you to cut yourself, your fingers and whatnot. So what I'm actually going to do, I'm going to measure down 12 inches. And then I'm going to square a line down, but this line, I'm not going to actually square it down, I'm going to make it 6 degrees. And this is because I use 6 degree wedges. And then from this line, I'm going to measure 2 inches. And this line gets squared down. Now, if you are doing this, this is basically to suit me. So if you are doing it, you want to be doing it to suit you. Now, I use a lot of material that's like 21 millimeters thick. So then I just use a mortar gauge and I set the depth of the notch, which is, for me, I'm going to set it at 2¼ inch.
cleaned the rail up. I haven't bothered cleaning the faces up, but it's just more the edges there that I've cleaned up. So what I've done, I've actually measured down. I don't know if you can see this on camera, but I've measured down from the underside, the same measurements on both sides. So that's basically gonna let us, you know, get this level across. So one of the reasons I'm actually doing this is because you can actually rest your planes on this rail. It's really handy to get them out of the way. That's the bench done, basically. So if you like what you're seeing, give us a thumbs up. What do you want to see next? Would you be interested in me making a shave horse attachment for this? Comment down below and let us know what you want to see. If I get enough interest, I will do a shave horse attachment. Thanks for watching, guys.